Greetings. I welcome you to worship this morning, live streaming from St. Luke's United Church of Christ in Independence, Missouri. Thank you for inviting us into your day, wherever you may be. We hope that you will engage as fully as is possible in the service today. Greet one another. Let us know where you're worshiping from. Access the readings for the service in the comments and follow along in the bulletin, which may also be accessed through links in the comments. Share your prayer requests with us. Online hosts are available to answer any questions that you might have. Opportunities for giving will be made available and posted during the time of worship and offering in today's service. The season of Advent begins next Sunday. This is always a special time in the life and worship at St. Luke's. We hope you will join us for the weekly lighting of the Advent wreath. I encourage you to gather candles and set up your own Advent wreath on your home altar as you join us for live stream Advent worship. Because we know that being back in the sanctuary is on everyone's Christmas wish list this year, we're offering a special Advent sanctuary experience. You're invited to register for a private, individual, or family group visit into the sanctuary during Advent. You will hear the recorded music of Margie and Matthew from last year's Christmas and Advent services. You will receive communion and reflect on the beauty of the Advent sanctuary. Registration is required and may be made online beginning after today's worship service or by calling the church office. COVID-19 social distancing precautions will be followed for these private and individual visits into the sanctuary. Part of our Advent tradition at St. Luke's is the annual Advent movie. Each year, we select a movie and find in it lessons for our Advent journey. This year's movie is The Polar Express. The Polar Express is a popular and readily available holiday favorite. I encourage you to watch the movie and listen for references and loose interpretations each week in our Advent worship. In that movie, passengers on the Polar Express have their tickets punched with a word that focuses them on the lesson that they might learn or remember. As part of our Advent experience, we are distributing tickets with a randomly selected word. It is an invitation for reflection as you explore where your ticket word might take you during our Advent journey. Tickets were enclosed in the annual Christmas letter that went out at the end of the week. If you are not on the mailing list and would like to receive your own unique ticket word, text the word Advent to the number in the comments or call the church office. Matthew is putting together a video to be shown during the virtual Christmas Eve service, and he would like for you to take pictures of individuals or families in the dark with lit candles. Think about the time when we would dim the lights and have candles at the end of our Christmas Eve service. So take your family pictures or your individual picture and email them to Matthew by December the 6th. Matthew, are you getting any response to that?
Yeah, yeah.
Good. Getting some pictures. So if you haven't gotten yours in to Matthew, please do so by December the 6th. We are again participating in the Independence School District's Holiday Helpers campaign. We would be collecting money through December the 4th. These donations go to families in need in our school district that aren't being helped by other programs. A family from our congregation will be matching all of our gifts up to $500. You can mail a check or use the app on our website. A lot of preparation is being made for the upcoming Advent and Christmas season, and we hope that you will be a part of our virtual worship experience. But first, let us take time to focus on today. Today in worship, you will have the opportunity to give thanks and express gratitude to God for the blessings of life. So let us enter God's gates with thanks, God's courtyard with our praise. Let us thank God and bless God's name.
please join in our call to worship? Come before the Lord with praise and thanksgiving.
We worship God with gladness.
Come before the Lord with gratitude and joy.
We shower God with our praise.
Come before the Lord with grateful hearts.
We bless God's holy name.
Call to confession. In pursuit of what we desire, or caught up in all that we have received, we sometimes fail to express proper gratitude to God. Sharing what we have received often does not make its way into our daily lives or even our worship. Let us open our eyes to all that we have received from God and dare yet to seek one more thing, forgiveness. Prayer of confession. Gracious God, our minds are filled with thoughts of what we need. The focus of our concern is too often limited to ourselves. Our gratitude for the blessings that you bestow upon us fails to be expressed in our worship of you and in our commitment to honor you with all that we have received. Forgive us of our lack of gratitude. With grateful hearts, we would offer you now our thanks and praise for your enduring love and never-ending faithfulness to us. Amen.
The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. In Christ we are forgiven and raised to the newness of life and joy. Thanks be to God. Good morning. You noticed my tie today? Many sure did. My tie, I'm not sure that you can see it, but my tie has Mickey Mouse on it. It's my Mickey Mouse tie, and I keep it for special occasions. And this week happens to be a special occasion, because this past week, Mickey Mouse had a birthday. Do you know how old Mickey Mouse was this week? He had his 92nd birthday, 92 years old. Looks pretty good for 92. And, well, as we wished Mickey Mouse a happy birthday on our daily live stream, Minnie was kind of sad, because here it was, Mickey Mouse's birthday. A big day at the Magic Kingdom, but Minnie is quarantined alone with me here in the study at the church. And so she was feeling kind of sad that she couldn't get to be with Mickey Mouse on his birthday. It is kind of sad when quarantines and social distancing doesn't let us get to be with the people we love and we want to celebrate with. That can be a sad time. And Minnie was kind of sad. And we spent the day doing some things to try to remember and celebrate Mickey's birthday in each and every way we could. So on our daily live stream, we wished Mickey a happy birthday. We even sang to him in my study together, and we spent some time watching the Disney Channel and Disney Plus and watching some movies of Mickey and Minnie together and remembering times that they had. And well, while it was kind of sad we couldn't be together, it made us feel more connected. And we realized through watching the movies and wishing Mickey a birthday, happy birthday, that we were together somehow in spirit. And so it made me miss all of my friends I couldn't be with on Sunday mornings and maybe some we can't even be with on Thanksgiving Day. And I got to thinking about an old movie clip that we had from worship. And I think we might be able to see a part of that and remember a time when we could all be together again, when the kids were here and singing. So we're going to try to share that today with you in children's time. Jeff, are we going to be able to do that? Okay. Oh, my computer went to sleep. I hope that that's the only one in my congregation today who does, but we will see. Hold with us. We will be right with you. Even computers get sleepy. Especially when Pastor Paul is droning on and on. There we go. This is from a while back, quite a while back, if we look at the size of some of my friends on here. Thought that would be fun, especially for Thanksgiving, to remember when we were together. And I had a lot of help calling us to thank God and be thankful, because no one can make us appreciate the blessings of life like our children. So we thank God today for that memory. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for special memories that we have when we can't be together, and for letting us know that whether we're together or apart, we are always together in spirit. We pray your blessings on each and every one who is special and close to us, and help us understand sometimes a loving thing to do is to stay apart and keep one another safe. Bless all my friends this Thanksgiving, and I'm thankful for each and every one of them. Look forward to the day we can be together again real soon. Amen. Over the last week, we've had more and more of friends and family members either quarantined or having to test for COVID-19, and we are all in that anxious time today. So we remember and think about those who have been affected and infected by COVID-19 across our community, within our congregation, and so many of our friends and family. As we pray today, we lift them up for healing, for peace of mind, for comfort. We pray for today those who are on hospital staffs that find themselves overworked, hospital systems that are overburdened with caring for folks, for the essential workers who are putting themselves in the way of harm and at risk to take care of their own families and the essential services that they provide. There's so much today which we are missing, so much today which brings uncertainty and fears and anxieties. So we lift those up. We lift those concerns up. But let our hearts and our minds also find room, even during these days, for thankfulness to God. Let us pray. O God, our desire in this moment is to come before you with our prayers of thanksgiving. For some of us, these words we offer will flow easily from our lips. For others, trying to name our blessings may prove more difficult. This year has brought many demands and limitations to our lives. We seem to have lost or been asked to give up so much. Even things we have taken for granted may not be possible this year. Gathering with family, so many traditions, These realities may reshape our prayers as well as our days. The challenges of this year may cause our prayers to include lament. But let not our prayer end there. Let us focus not so much on material things, whether their absence or scarcity, but rather how we are living our lives. Grateful, together or apart, for family. Grateful, together or apart, for compassion that foregoes our wishes for the good of others. Indeed, we are family. We are community. We are loved. We are blessed. For this, together or apart, we are grateful. For this, we offer you our thanks. Now, from all the places we may be worshiping today, let us lift our voices as we pray as our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
The scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, beginning with verse 11. I'll be reading from the Common English Bible. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 men with skin disease approached him. Keeping their distance from him, they raised their voices and said, "Jesus, Master, show us mercy." When Jesus saw them, he said, "Go show yourselves to the priests." After they left, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw that he had been healed, returned and praised God with a loud voice. He fell on his face at Jesus' feet and thanked him. He was a Samaritan. Jesus replied, "Weren't 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? No one returned to praise God except this foreigner." Jesus said to him, "Get up and go. Your faith has healed you." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. There are several windows through which to look into the gospel reading for today. The first being to focus upon the fact that the only person to return to offer gratitude to Jesus for the healing he had received was a Samaritan. This is not the only time Jesus raised eyebrows to drive home an important point by honoring the virtue of a Samaritan. He had done so in a story of the Good Samaritan, who was the only one who had compassion and cared for a victim who had fallen among thieves. The Samaritans were social outcasts among the Jews to whom Jesus was speaking. To recognize the virtue of a Samaritan might well have been Jesus' way to rile his hearers. Perhaps the favor shown to the Samaritans on such occasions was to call attention to the prejudices that were made to feel uncomfortable when so much as presented with the idea that anything good could ever be seen in the likes of a Samaritan. It is a worthy perspective from which to view Luke's narrative, one which might call us to assess our own judgments, our own dismissals of others who may be different from us, those who, for whatever the reason, are the marginalized of our day. So go ahead, let this passage read you through that window. In whom might Jesus find virtue that would shock you? Then there's the window of thanksgiving through which the lectionary seems to invite us to see this story. It is a familiar perspective and interpretation. Often the focus of Thanksgiving sermons, this passage admonishes us to take time to offer expressions of gratitude for whatever it is that we have received. The 9 men who are healed and went on their way without offering an expression of gratitude teach us the difference between being happy with what we have received and being grateful for what we have received. They call us to be mindful of not only what we have received, but to be aware of the source from which our blessings come. Thanksgiving is about more than counting your blessings. It is about acknowledging that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights, as the Epistle of James reminds us. That is certainly an appropriate perspective on this story. Shall we call it the story of the grateful Samaritan as we approach Thanksgiving? That's the two windows through which we usually view today's scripture reading. However, from where we currently stand, we might have a whole new perspective on this passage. This year, as social distancing guidelines have become a necessary part of our daily routine, we might see this story from a different window. We might focus more on the illness of the 10 men and the social implications that their disease carried for them. In biblical times, leprosy was the coronavirus of the day. It was contagious. As such, even without modern science telling them to do so, people knew for the good of the community the necessity of social distancing. And as fear and personal vulnerability will do, the disease brought out the worst sort of social ostracism, division, and yes, even judgment. These are just some of the social burdens on those who suffered from the disease. The pain and suffering were matched only by the physical symptoms of the disease, a disease for which there was no known cure. None except the healing that Jesus was said to be able to provide, that is. So there they were, 10 men who suffered from the physical and social plight of leprosy, quarantined, unable to gather with family for holidays or any other day, unable to gather with community at the temple or the synagogue. Then it happened. They saw Jesus, the walking hope of cure, approaching them. They did what anyone would do in their situation. They approached Jesus, keeping their distance, of course, crying out for his mercy, which in their case could have only meant being cured, being released from the physical and social suffering that had come to define them and the world in which they were forced to live. We've heard the story often enough to no longer be surprised by what happens. We know that Jesus, the compassionate healer that he was, would not fail to show mercy on those who were suffering. Familiarity veils the miraculous. How is it that when we become desensitized to 10 men being miraculously healed from such dreadful disease? How indeed? Imagine this story unfolding in our day. So many people, millions, being infected by the coronavirus. Then along comes hope, healing. Those who had been suffering the pain of social isolation and physical distress suddenly made well. You have to wonder, don't you, how we are going to respond as we emerge from the depths of this global pandemic. What will be our first move when we are free to move about once again? So off they go, rejoicing, no doubt. We are left to imagine where they might have gone. Maybe, as Jesus suggested, they went to show themselves to the priests. Now, the priests were the appointed authority on pronouncing diagnosis on leprosy due to the holiness codes associated with the disease. In effect, Jesus healed them and told them to go down to the clinic to be tested, undoubtedly to receive the confirmation of a negative test. Where did they go then? Home to sit down together with family they hadn't been at a table with for who knows how long? To a favorite restaurant they had not eaten in for longer than they could remember? Maybe they just wanted to walk through the crowded marketplace without having to call out, "Unclean, unclean," as they had been required to do because of their illness. We can imagine where they might have gone first, but we don't know where they actually went, except for one of them, a Samaritan. The Samaritan, we are told, was the only one who approached Jesus after he was healed. He returned and praised God. He fell on his face at Jesus' feet and thanked him. 1 in 10. That's how many we know expressed gratitude for the healing mercy that had all been released from the same suffering. All of them were undoubtedly glad, happy to have been healed, celebrating the restored liberty of returning to normal. But gratitude is about more than being happy you have received something you longed for or needed. Thankfulness is more than rushing out to enjoy the good fortune that might have come your way. It is important to take note of this lesson because eventually we will be released from the throes of the pandemic. It is important for us, as we are imagining what we will do first, to bear in mind that gratitude should direct our path and remain a priority. We would like to assume that Thanksgiving will be a priority when we get back to normal. But how much was gratitude really a part of our normal before? How long will it be before we are again taking simple things for granted? How many of us will emerge from the pandemic with a sense of gratitude when there is so much to enjoy, so much lost time to make up? Let's hope that our statistics are better than 1 in 10. How can we do better? How can we at least be the one? For that lesson, let us think about the grateful Samaritan. It is a lesson that need not wait until we have received the healing or whatever it is that we might need. This is a lesson in gratitude that is for here and now, while we wait. I have to wonder if the grateful Samaritan hadn't nurtured a spirit of gratitude even in the confines of his suffering. You see, gratitude seems to need some measure of constraint, which might be difficult to come by in times of abundance when there is so much to enjoy. I suggest that the Samaritan might have developed just that kind of gratitude throughout his long bout with suffering and scarcity. It is only a gratitude that is deep enough to reach to the depths of despair that rises to the occasion of abundance. In order to be the 1 in 10, you have to develop a genuine sense of gratitude while yet in the confines of scarcity. Whether or not we find it in ourselves to be thankful, even without the familiar refrain of family traditions and gatherings, might well be an indicator of the gratitude we will have on the other side of the pandemic. We know we're supposed to be thankful. If we stop and think about it, we can easily enough think of things for which we are thankful, even in a pandemic. But if you're like me, there have been times that it was easier to do. I'm just not quite feeling it. Not right now. Maybe later. Maybe by Thursday. Maybe by Christmas. Maybe when this nightmarish year finally comes to an end. Surely by spring I will be thankful. Won't we all? Hear the lesson of the grateful Samaritan. Let gratitude be nurtured in the shadowy confines of any and every place you find yourself. For a gratitude that is able to abide in the depths of need is the only gratitude that will rise to the occasion of being truly thankful for abundance. Amen.
Thank you.
Remembering all that God has done for us, let us bring our offerings with thanksgiving and praise. Acknowledging that all we have comes from God, let us offer these gifts to sustain and bless the ministry of our congregation in this community and beyond. I want to thank you for your generous and faithful support for sharing in the ministry at St. Luke's. I invite you to pray with me as we dedicate our gifts and our lives to God. God of all good gifts, for the blessings you have given us, for family and friends who enrich our lives, our hearts overflow with thanksgiving to you. We have been sustained and empowered by your generosity. In Christ, you have shown us a way to wholeness and peace. Accept our offerings of thanksgiving and praise, and may all of our days be a living sacrifice of devotion to you. Amen. May God's gracious hand continue to bless you abundantly. May God's wings of shelter continue to keep you. And may your heart respond now and always with gratitude. Be well.